पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः।
We'll chant from mantra 1 to mantra 8 of Ishavasi Upanishad.
Om Ishavasya Midago Sarvam Yatkincha Jagatyam Jagat Tena Tyaktena Bhunjithamagridah Kasya Svidhanam कुर्वन्नेवेह कर्माणि जिजीविषे क्षतगो समाः एवं त्वयि नान्यथेतोऽस्ति न कर्म लिप्यते नरे असूर्यानामते लोका अन्धेन तमसा भृताः तागुस्ते प्रेत्याभिगच्छन्ति ये केचात्महनो जनाः अनेजदेकं मनसो जवीयो नैनद्देवा आप्नुवन् पूर्वमर्षत् तद्धावतो ज्ञानत्ये विदिष्ठत्तस्मिन्नपो मातरिष्वा दधाति तदेजति तन्नैजति तद्दूरे तद्वन्दिके तदन्तरस्य सर्वस्य तदु सर्वस्यास्य बाह्यतः यस्तु सर्वाणि भूतान्यात्मन्येवानुपश्यति सर्वभूतेषु चात्मानं ततो न विजुगुप्सते यस्मिन् सर्वाणि भूतान्यात्मैवाभूद्विजानतः तत्र को मोहः कः शोक एकत्वमनुपश्यतः सपर्यगाच्छुक्रमकायमव्रणमस्नाभिरगो शुद्धमपापविद्धम् कविर्मनीषी परिभूस्वयं भूयाथा कथ्यतोऽर्थान्यदधाक्षाश्वतीभ्यः समाभ्यः।
ईशावास्यम इदं सर्वं यत्किंच जगत्यां जगत् ऑल दिस इज परवेडेड बाय द सुप्रीम लॉर्ड बाय ईश्वरा द इम्प्लिकेशन इज दैट व्हाट एवर वी सी इन द वर्ल्ड एज नेम्स एंड फॉर्म्स इन दिस एवर चेंजिंग यूनिवर्स दैट मस्ट बी कवर्ड बाय ईश्वरा दैट इज द विजन that we need to develop. How do we get there? He says, Tena Tyaktena Bhunjita. May you enjoy by renunciation. Tyaga is Boga. What we are asked to renounce is that which is the obstacle to reaching the Self. By raising our vision to a higher pedestal, we will be able to get off the lower attachments. And Magrida Kasya Svidhanam, for whose wealth is it? Do not covet anybody's wealth. This is the piece of advice that is given. There is nothing other than yours is the philosophical implication. You cannot rob from yourself. Left hand cannot take from the right hand, and that is not to be taken as something that you have acquired. There is nothing apart from you, so for whose is the wealth? So the first mantra is a very grand opening to the Upanishad, which talks about a comprehensive state and the spiritual sadhana, and it is addressed to the highest level of seekers. So the path of meditation and renunciation is given in the mantra 1. For those who cannot renounce the world and go to the higher realms of understanding Isha to be covering this entire universe, who cannot visualize that level, who want to continue living in the world, who are having lot of rajas in them, for them karma is sanction. May you live 100 years doing action. Kurvanneveha karmani jiji vishet. If you wish to live here, keep on doing karma for 100 years non-stop. 100 years means non-stop you keep on doing this karma. There is no other path for you except this, because karma doesn't taint man. Doesn't taint means it does not leave a mark. The type of action that is being talked about here is selfless karma. Selfless action is what the master knows, nothing else he knows. He knows nothing about selfishness. So what is covered in the entire 3rd and 4th chapter of Gita in Karma Yoga is covered in this one mantra here. May you live 100 years doing action. If you wish to live. If you don't wish to live, if you wish to realize, go to the mantra 1. May you renounce and enjoy. That is the advice that is given. So for, in general angle, if we say the sattvic people are the adhikaris for mantra 1 and somewhat the rajasic people is the adhikari for mantra 2, if you do not belong to these two categories, then there is no sort of scope for you that you end up committing spiritual suicide, which is given in mantra 3. Those who are in ignorance, they end up in Asurya Loka, a loka where there is no sun, sunless world. Obviously, it is referring to the Naraka, where there is absolute darkness, where your tamasic karma leads you. Of course, he is not just mentioning that. The sunless world is categorized into two categories. The suprahuman are also sunless, in the sense of when they go beyond the realms of the heaven. And the infrahumans, which are below the category of humans at a very lower stage, they are also deemed sunless. Those who do extremely selfish actions and go to hell and who are experiencing that, there is no question about it. But what is interesting is, from the point of view of the highest self, even a sojourn in the highest realm of heaven, where you are merely going through the enjoyments as a result of your action, with no scope of further conscious effort to go towards the self, is not considered a great achievement. So you need to only be in this world to do karma and then to go to renunciation and meditation and to realize the self is the idea that is indicated there. And therefore, those people who have got a chance as human beings to use their self-effort, purushartha, to realize the self here, if they do not do and they end up in sunless world, they are as though killing the self within themselves. Obviously, we know that Atman cannot be killed or cut, all that is correct. But what it means is that they are not giving them any chance for the Atman to manifest in a very small way also. So, they are said to be in the sunless world. Those worlds enveloped by blinding darkness are deemed sunless. Those people slaying their self and departing, they go to them. So, these are the first three waves of the Upanishad, which talks about three distinct categories of people. The next topic is from mantras 4 to 8. It talks about the goal of evolution. What is that self, what is the Swarupa Lakshana of it, is given in mantra 4. We'll chant mantra 4 twice.
अनेजदेकं मनसो जवीयो नैनद्देवा आनुवन् पूर्वमर्षत् तद्धावतो ज्ञानत्येति तिष्ठत्तस्मिन्नपो मातरिष्वा दधाति अनेजदेकं मनसो जवीयो नैनद्देवा आनुवन् पूर्वमर्षत् तद्धावतो ज्ञानत्येति तिष्ठत्तस्मिन्नपो मातरिष्वा दधाति
That is unmoving. One. Faster than mind. The senses could not reach it. It ran ahead. Remaining stationary, it outruns other runners. It being there, air sustains life. In topic 4, we see a liberal use of contradictory language, and more so in the next mantra. Mantra 4 and Mantra 5 point out to the goal that has to be reached, which we say as Swarupa Lakshana of Brahman. What is that Brahman in essence? Mantra 4 talks about that from the microcosmic point of view. Mantra 5 talks about from the macrocosmic point of view. Of course, you can derive the message and interpret it from both, in both the mantras. That is, you will find an indication, a slight indication of macrocosm also in mantra 4 and microcosm also in mantra 5. But overall, mantra 4 talks about Brahman's original nature from a microcosmic point of view, from the individual's point of view, and the next mantra from the universe point of view. Anejat means unmoving. Brahman is unmoving because it is all pervading. Anything can move only from a place where it is to where it is not. Since it is all pervading, there is no scope of any movement. Therefore, it is called as anejat. Therefore, with reference to space, you cannot divide Brahman. It is an all pervading entity. This is indicated by the word anejat. Ekam. One, it is indicating that it cannot be divided with reference to vastu or a thing. See, in the first mantra, the invocation, it is said that purnam, word is used as purnam. Purnam means that which is whole. The definition of purnam is that which cannot be divided from the point of view of time, space or a thing. Desha, kala, vastu. Aparichinna. Desha kala aparichinna vastu. That which is not divided from the point of view of time, space or a thing. So, anejat talks about the purna vastu from space point of view, which is undivided in space. Ekam is one. Ekam is a very beautiful word which refers to one. In fact, in some other places, advayam is also given. Advayam means nothing other than one. No second. That is even more powerful. Because one gives you sort of a picture of a boundary. But one is a very beautiful word. Complete word. There is nothing other than it. But to emphasize more on this, Advayam is given later. Advayam means that alone is there. Nothing else apart from is there. Say, suppose you say clock is there. Apart from it, the mobile is there. Means they are two different things. But from Brahman, apart from it, nothing is there. Anejat ekam. Manasaha javiyaha, faster than mind. We cannot imagine this. For us, what is known as the fastest entity in this world is our own mind. Before you go to Tirupati, the mind is already there. If you want to go to Tirupati, how long it will take? If you take a flight, it may take from now 5 hours minimum. Like that it is. But if you want to go to Tirupati now, you are already there. The mind is already gone. If you want to go to Badrinath, America, moon, you can be there. So, mind is very fast. But here he says, it is faster than the mind. Very interesting. Faster than the mind means it is moving, right? First he has said unmoving. In fact, next mantra is going to make it even more clear. Clear in the sense, even more complicated. But here he says, Manaso Javiya means it is faster than the mind. How can something which is not moving be faster than the mind? What does it mean?
It was already there.
So, before your mind reaches Tirupati, Brahman is already there. How? It is there in the form of Tirupati. That which is there in Tirupati is not different from Brahman. So, before your mind reaches there, Brahman is already there. So, therefore, it is faster than your mind also. Manaso Javiyaha. Naina Deva Apnuvan. Even the Devas have not attained. The Devas have not attained. Devas are superior being to us. They are gods. Devas have not attained because it is unattainable. It is not something you can attain from any practice which is aiming outside you. You can attain success. You can attain money. And remember, whatever is attained also will be there for a while. If you attain it like Ravana or Hiranyakashipu, it will be there for a long time. But it is still temporary from the absolute point of view. Brahma's age is also temporary. He has got Brahma's position, which is like a permanent thing, but it is not really permanent. At the end of the time, Brahma also has to go. His time is over. So anything that is attained will remain with you for a while and then it will go. That which is there forever cannot be attained. It is there within you as it is. This even the Devas don't know. Therefore, from that angle, from that point of view of ignorance, from the absolute level, gods, humans, animals, plants, Brahma, starting from Brahma till the last ant or the mosquito or bacteria, whatever you can think of, all are in the ignorant realm only. In fact, in this context, again, in one way, humans are better off than devas, than gods. What is the reason?
Human means that you can straight away get to Brahman, devas have to come back and then.
And the reason for that is?
Govian.
Okay.
Because the karma has been more based on. Good karmas, but more for self-interest
and selfless. See, and the effect of that is, of course, Swarga, as you said, it is based on your good karma. You go, you have to enjoy there. The moment a person keeps on enjoying more and more, the thought of self or self-realization doesn't automatically come. For humans, the blessing of sorrow is there, dukkha is there. When dukkha becomes sort of unbearable, invariably your thought goes to God even as to relieve it. So therefore we find mumukshus. Mumukshus means those who are desirous of liberation amongst humans, not amongst devas. Devas are there maybe with power, that is also God because of their tapas, their karma, whatever. They have to be there, they have to enjoy it, they have to experience it in this angle. So therefore it is said that in a way that humans are better off than devas. Here it says devas also it is not attainable. Purva Marshat, that which is the consciousness before everything, that which is the consciousness before everything, even the devas could not attain it. You saw in the Keno Upanishad there is a story in the third mantra. Brahman is in the form of apparition. Agni could not reach it or know it. Vayu could not reach it or know it. Indra also could not reach it or know it. All these are devas. So what is the... We said this mantra is from microcosmic point of view. Devas means senses. What deva... Naina deva apnuvan means the senses cannot reach it. Your eyes cannot catch it with its vision. The ears cannot hear, the skin cannot touch, The nose cannot smell. The tongue cannot taste. Brahman is not an object of perception. So that is what is meant by that Naina Deva Apnuvan Purva Masha. Therefore, when the Agni is trying to go and reach Brahman, it is already there. When the Indra is trying to reach it, he is already disappeared. So therefore, wherever your senses can go, it outruns you. It is faster than you. Very poetically given here. That is unmoving, one, faster than mind. The senses could not reach it. It ran ahead. Whenever senses or anything try to reach it, it just goes ahead of it. So even in the temple, when you go with eyes open for darshan, you are able to somewhat grasp it with your feeling when you close your eyes only. So all the senses are shut off, means the senses have their limitations and they are standing there. It has already crossed the realm of the senses and gone somewhere else. Then the mind and intellect tries. It can also not reach. That is why it says, manaso javiyaha. It is faster than the mind also. So the first line covers that it is beyond your mind, it is beyond your senses. Taddhavato. Tat means that. In this mantra itself, two words are given. Enath. Enath means this. Tat means that. We use the word this to indicate something which is close to you. We use the word tat to indicate something which is very far from you. We say this book and that Ganesha, or this Ganesha and that fan, you say. Whatever is closer to you is this. Whatever is farther away from you is that. Atman is the closest thing to you within your heart. Closer than your body, closer than your mind and intellect, closer than your prana, that which is seated in the heart core of your personality is this. This. So first it starts with Enat. Now he says Tat. Tat means farthest, whatever you can think. You can think in terms of earth or water or then fire or wind or space or even Brahmaloka, space up to that level. It is all beyond that. So Tat refers to that. Tat Dhavato. It outruns all other runners, remaining stationary. So again he emphasizes that without moving, being in a place, it is able to beat all other runners. In aquarium you go, there are various type of fish that is there. There is a shark, there is various other small fish. But if you ask, which is the fastest one there? The answer is the water. Wherever you keep a race, let blue whale come first or shark come first. But before the shark reaches there, the water is always there. But water doesn't move. In that enclosure of water, it doesn't move at all. So without moving, it outruns all other fish in this example. Exactly like that. Without moving, Atman is able to outrun all other runners. Before any other equipment or any other agent can reach Brahman, it is always ahead of it. It is always further than it. So, it is saying in a poetic way, being stationary, it outruns all other runners. Now, it can be taken as an indication of, it cannot be reached by organs of action also. In the first line, it said that, organs of perception cannot reach it. Mind means mind and intellect cannot reach it. Now he says, organs of action also cannot reach it. How organs of action? It is indicated by these two words. Tasmin. Tasmin means in it. Tasmin, in it. Apaha. Matarishva Dadati. Here it is translated as activities of life. Apaha. Apaha, the root is apaha. Apaha means water. The activities of life emanate from the organs of action. And action can emanate only from when you have a form. Form can be there only when there is water in you. Water is that which gives form to everything. Anything that is dehydrated loses its form. So therefore, water is there because water is there, form is there. Because form is there in you, you do all the activities, and all the activities are sustained by air, Matarishva. So from microcosmic point of view, what it means is the prana sustains the activities of the body, the mind, everything, because it is there in it. So that which is causing everything to happen is the supreme Atma within you. Because of it, the air sustains the life, life activities. Life activities is indicated by apaha here. This is from microcosmic point of view. So therefore, organs of action mind cannot reach it. Organs of action cannot reach it. Organs of perception cannot reach it. Prana cannot reach it. Prana is sustaining life because of this. And as I said, a small indication is there that it is indicating the creation from the macrocosmic point of view also. In the creation theory, it is said that from it came the space, then the air, then the fire, then water, then the earth, then the plants, then the beings. From plants, the food, from food, the beings, from being, the activities. This is the krama that is given. It is there in Gita also. It is there in Upanishads also. So, just to indicate that these two are given, that Matarishva and water. Not that all the things are given. We need not even take it from this angle. But for those who are interested, it's a very subtle indication, because in various Upanishads, this krama is indicated. So, here water and air is used to indicate that it is because of it from which the entire creation and activities also come out. But main focus of this mantra is that from the microcosmic point of view, it is that unmoving entity of consciousness within you which makes everything happen, but which cannot be reached by any of your equipments. So you take it from the equipment of mind and intellect, organs of perception, action and prana, or it is covering all koshas. Of course, bliss sheath is not given. Otherwise, annamaya, pranamaya, manomaya, vijnanamaya, all koshas are given. It is that which is beyond all the koshas, which activates all the koshas. That is the lesson here. That is unmoving. Yes.
So can we just connect this to Tattva Bodha that says that Atman is not a subtle body? The subtle body consists of all the perception, all the action. And
that is true. Atman is different from that all, which is correct.
But basically it connects to Tattva Bodha also.
Tattva Bodha is giving the basic principles only, but that is all derived from the Upanishads only. That is unmoving, one faster than mind. The senses could not reach it. It ran ahead. Remaining stationary, it outruns other runners. It being there, air sustains life. Mantra 5 we will chant twice.
Tade jati tannai jati tadure tadvandike tadantarasya sarvasya tadu sarvasyasya bahyatah tade jati tannai jati tadure tadvandike tadantarasya sarvasya tadu sarvasyasya bahyatah.
That moves not. That is afar, that is even near, that is inside all this, that is even outside all this. This is one mantra which liberally uses, as I said, the language of contradiction. Three pairs of contradictory terms are given here. It moves not. It is afar, it is near. It is within, it is without. It is inside everything. It is outside everything. Here, from the macrocosmic point of view, Brahman is described. Very clearly, the last mantra started with the term anejat. That means it doesn't move. Here, very clearly, it starts with the term that it ejati means it moves, but it moves should not be taken in separation. It, you have to combine it with the next term, na ejati. It moves not. So first, what it is trying to say is, in terms of the expression in the universe, that which is moving is also Brahman, that which is not moving is also Brahman. In various places, these terms are used, charam and acharam. Charam means that which charati, moves. Acharati means that which doesn't move. Even living beings, they use charam and acharam to indicate plants and animals. That is, animals and humans move from place to place. Plant doesn't move from place to place, within a place. But from a bigger point of view, plants, animals and humans are moving, because plants move in a place and they also grow. But a house or a rock or a mountain doesn't move. They are all called as non-living beings. So that which is non-living being is also nothing but expression of the Brahman. That which is living being which moves is also nothing but the expression of Brahman. Therefore, in living being it moves, in a non-living being it doesn't move. Tat ejati, tat na ejati. This is a very direct meaning to combine these two and understand that whatever you see as expression in the world, moving and unmoving, all are nothing but Brahman and Brahman alone. Now, from the point of view of consciousness, we know that consciousness is all pervading, it does not move, which is clear. It can move only from a place where it is not to where it is not, from where it is to where it is not. So, it is, that is not the case here. It cannot move because it is all pervading. But conditioned consciousness moves. Consciousness in its purest form doesn't move. Conditioned consciousness moves. The famous example always quoted, and it is given in various books of Swamiji, is that sun above is one, that sun doesn't move. It's stationary. Sunlight, which is all pervading, gets reflected in various reflecting media. When a mirror reflects the sunlight, it takes the properties of the reflecting medium. If the reflecting medium is broken, the sun is broken. If it is dirty, the sun is dirty. If it is blue, the sun is blue. If it is like in a water which is agitated, the reflected sun is also agitated. All this is the properties of the reflected sun. It has nothing to do with the sun above. When you are removing the mirror from one frame and fixing it in another frame, in the medium of all pervading sunlight, the reflected sun inside the mirror actually moves. What is the reflected sun here? The reflected sun is the individual consciousness. In our subtle body, the supreme consciousness gets reflected. When the movement of subtle body is there, forget even from moving from place to place. As and when your mind moves, to that extent your ego, your conditioned consciousness also is subject to movement. And in the case of birth and death, it is very clear that it is no more there reflecting in this body, it is there somewhere else. So there is a movement possible, and this movement is what is described in various verses in Gita and other things, that Atma moves from one, like from childhood to youth to old age, how it moves within a body. After death, it moves from one body to another. Such statements are given for us to contemplate. But the basis of that is that movement is possible. But that movement is not pertaining to the supreme Atman. It is only pertaining to the conditioned Atman. But people believe out of ignorance that the Atma moves. Atma cannot move. The supreme Atma cannot move. Atma Bodha gives a very beautiful example to prove this. When, as a child, you would have also played this game on a somewhat clear sky where some clouds are there. You see in the evening, moon is there. When you run from one place to another, the moon also seems to come running with you. It is there running with you. But relatively, in this example, moon is stationary. What is making you feel that as though the moon is moving? It's actually the clouds are moving in the opposite direction. That is what makes you understand that the moon is moving with you. The movement is of the clouds. It is not of the moon. If you are able to fix your focus on the moon, you will understand that it is not moving. Since unconsciously our focus is on the cloud, we assume as though the moon is moving. But what is interesting is the cloud itself gets illuminated and you are able to visualize that only because the moon is there. Exactly like that, it is out of ignorance that we think that the Atma is moving, says Shankaracharya, but Atma cannot move. It is the conditioned consciousness which moves according to your desires, your vasanas. It movement is there. Movement means energy is there. Matter transforms into various energies. Like that, your desire is also energy that makes you act, and as in the process, you also move. You identify with this body, mind and intellect and you move. But the Supreme Consciousness doesn't move at all. So, we can say that it moves, it doesn't move. Swamiji quotes another example. When a person is going from here to Delhi, let us say, he is there, boarded the plane now, and 2 hours flight. He is fast asleep in the plane. He got down. So the guest or the host in Delhi says that you must be very tired. No, I'm not tired. I slept very well, you say. You slept? Then on the phone you are saying, I just flew from Calcutta to Delhi, you say. So, are you really flying or are you really sleeping? Flying is movement. Sleeping is no movement. So, how can both these things go together? With reference to the plane, you are sleeping. With reference to the people who are outside the plane, you are flying. So, with reference to plane, you are not moving inside. With reference to the people outside, you are part of the plane which is moving. So at the same time, you can say that you are moving and you are not moving. So with reference to the equipments, Atman is moving. By itself, it doesn't move. Electricity doesn't have any movement, but it moves in a motor. Petrol doesn't have movement. It moves in a car. Car has movement and car's movement is not possible without petrol. You can say the petrol activates the movement in the petrol in the car. So the Atman speaks in a microphone. Atman cools in a refrigerator. Atman heats in the electricity heats in a heater. So electricity is unmoving by itself, but electricity causes all the movements in all the equipments. So we can very clearly say that it moves, yet it moves not. Then he says, tad dure tad antike. It is far and it is near. What does it mean? First meaning is that it is
moving. It's everywhere.
It's everywhere. That which is far and that which is near means that which is all pervading. This is what Keno Upanishad also said in terms of that it is in the lightning, that it is in the blinking of your eye. Your blinking of the eye is the closest point to you as far as the external world is concerned, and lightning is the farthest point. It is there in lightning and it is there in the eye means it is there everywhere in between. So therefore, it is all pervading, it is everywhere. This is the meaning that we must derive out of this, that is far and that is near. But a person who has, let us say, gone to a place for the lecture, he has come because of the rain, he has carried umbrella. Though it was not raining, he carried the umbrella. And that umbrella, he has hung it very safely somewhere. After the lecture is over, he is searching for the umbrella. He said, in a very safe place, I hung it. Where is it? Where is it? He is asking everybody. Until one person points out that it is hanging on his shoulder. He has kept it very safely here. He is not aware of it and he is searching elsewhere. As long as he is searching elsewhere, the umbrella, where is the umbrella? It's very far. We do not know where it is, whether he will find it or not. The moment he understands that it is hanging on the back of his neck, it is very near to him. So, like in Atma Bodha, it says, Vakantha Bharana Metta, on the necklace on your neck. For those who have understood that this Atman is the entity which is the Antaryami within you, which is you yourself inside, it is very, very near. They understand it that way. But all others who are ignorant of it, you may go very far. So therefore, we believe we have to go all the way to Badrinath, Balaji, or any pilgrimage, Mecca, Jerusalem, to get a glimpse of it. It is very far. It is not even there. Then you have to go even further. That is, you can never, never reach it. That's why it is given in the previous mantra that it outruns every other thing. So, in general, for a person who is not evolved, it is very, very far. Indicated in some verses in Gita by saying that Bahunam Janmanam Ante Jnanavanman Prapatra. It is by, you know, after many, many Janmas. Very far for a person who really has no iota of introversion or no idea to know what self is, who has no satsang with him, who has no people around him who can get this, who can give the vibration of what that self is all about. For him, it is very, very far. But for a person who has understood the self to be within him, maybe even not realize the self, but it is a matter of time before he is going to reach it. For him, it is near. So for advanced spiritual practitioner, it is near. For a person who has just started the spiritual journey, or who doesn't know what self is, who is extremely extroverted in nature, who thinks materialism and sensualism is just the way of life, like an animal who lives, it is very, very far. So therefore, it is said that tad dure tad antike. For the wise people, it is near. For the ignorant, it is far. Yes.
Can we relate that to conditioned consciousness and this to consciousness?
Relate what?
The word that. When he's talking about that, that is the state of conditioned consciousness. And this, when he's talking about this over here, this is the state.
No, no, no. It is the same thing that is far and near. It is not two entities. Conditioned consciousness we use only in the first thing which is said at, that it moves and it moves not. That which moves not is the real consciousness. It appears to be moving when it is in a conditioned consciousness. It is also really not conditioned. But we have put ourselves in a state that we appear to be a conditioned consciousness. Yeah. That only moves. That has nothing to do. And yeah.
So, what about bhakti yoga? In a state of bhakti yoga, people only want to reach advanced level of realization and of. They, in bhakti, you tend to think that God is outside. So, otherwise, that bhakti doesn't come. If you start thinking that God is inside you, at least at my level, that is the feeling that, you know, in order to get bhakti, you want to feel that God is outside.
In fact, that is why when you go deeper into bhakti, you do feel it inside you only. It is not outside you. That is why we always say in temple, why do you close the eyes? It is an unconscious feeling that it is inside. In order to get that inspiration, first we need a murti outside, we need a temple, we need a pilgrimage, because we are not able to get rid of our thoughts and just concentrate on the self within. But once you go there in that conducive atmosphere and surrounding, unconsciously it was only tending to go within only. So it is not opposed to bhakti yoga. You can do karma yoga, bhakti yoga, jnana yoga, any yoga for that matter. But as long as the thought is towards the self, you are on the path. For such a person, it is near. It is near. A time will come where you understand Tirupati or the Vaishno Devi is within me. Then you may not that time want to go there, or may not, you may still go there for some other reason, but you will not, it is not that the inspiration comes only there. That is why from even practical point of view, you look at gross persons who are extremely egoistic in nature, selfish in nature, whose thoughts are only extroverted and running out into the world. For them to think of divinity, some magnificent expression of Brahman has to be there. So a person who goes all the way to Niagara Falls, which is a nature, or Himalayas, or Ganga where it meets the ocean, which is a huge expression, or ocean itself, which is not near, it is far. You have to go there. But when he goes there, he forgets himself and says, my God. Even such a person who constantly thinks of himself, or any meeting he thinks in terms of business contact and money, and you know, that sort of a person also, these magnificent expressions makes him forget himself and think of God, but it is very far because of his nature. When he becomes somewhat advanced in spiritual practice, if he goes to the terrace and sees the sunrise, that is very inspiring. Sunset is very inspiring. So in this expression, he is not just seeing the sun, he is seeing the expression of God as it were. So that is somewhat nearer than you go to Niagara or this thing. A very advanced spiritual practitioner, like a Wordsworth, whose state of mind was elated when he saw daffodils, that flower itself will inspire you. You peel a banana, it is closer to you. Where is banana? It's in your kitchen. There it is. So it's very close. So if you look at it that way, advanced spiritual practitioners are able to view even the expression of Brahman as a spirituality very near to them. It is there around you. When you shave in the morning and you see that something is pushing the hair 0.01 millimeter or whatever be the size it is pushing, but that is getting pushed daily, is nothing but an expression of Brahman. That our hair is growing, or everything for that matter, is just an expression of Brahman. They are able to visualize it. So for them, we see that it is near, but for others it is very far. So even for a person who has to, so that is why beyond that Swamiji says that beyond a Niagara or a magnificent expression, very gross persons need magic to prove that it is not existing. Magic means it is not there at all. In fact, miracle is there at every stage in our life. That sun and moon and everything is there in the antariksha, in the space itself, is a great miracle. But he is not able to visualize all these things. So suddenly a fire comes. Then he thinks, my God, something like that. It is like even a animal may be startled like that. So for a very gross person, it is far. For a subtle person who is introvert, it is near. That's how it should be. Now, then he says, tad antarasya sarvasya tadu sarvasyasya bahyataha. That is inside all this, that is even outside all this. Within everything refers to the immanent nature of Brahman. Outside everything refers to the transcendental nature of Brahman. That means it is all-pervading infinite entity is the direct meaning here. Though we find even words attributed to Christ like the kingdom of heaven is within you, which when interpreted has to mean this only. In general, the understanding of the other faiths, when I say other faiths, Abrahamic faiths like Islam or Christianity, talk about God only as a transcendental entity. God is somewhere very far from the world, who has, like a toy, he has given key to this universe and he has created it and he is there. And you have to surrender unto him for salvation. All this is the general understanding. So that is why core Christian concept, or those who practice it in a very deep way, they don't accept Atma to be there within you. Some of the core Christian groups in America are opposed to yoga, because yoga is just not physical exercises. Of course, that has caught up with all Americans. But yoga finally says, it is the union of the self from within you. They say, no, within you is not possible, because the body is inherently sinful. Body cannot house God, etc. That is, so, inside, or the immanent concept is not understood in general in the other texts. In fact, that limits God. If you say it is not inside you, that means it is only outside you, means it is finite, it is not infinite. Infinite means there is no place that he is not there. He is both inside and outside. What is this inside and outside? This boundary between inside and outside is created by your mind. In fact, there is no inside and outside. We have given this example before. You draw a circle here. When you draw a circle and you ask, what is inside the circle? The board is there inside the circle. What is there outside the circle? The board only. So the board is there inside the circle and outside the circle. Okay. This circle has created a boundary which is inside and outside. But actually, has the circle divided the board? The circle has not divided the board. In fact, technically speaking, Boat is not inside the circle. The circle is inside the boat. The circle is inside the boat. That circle has created an entity of differentiation as inside and outside. This circle is your subtle body. It is your mind. It is upon the creation of this subtle body that you have a notion that there is something which is me and there is something outside me. This is a notion which should not be accepted, says Shankaracharya. There is no such thing as this. Now, the proof of that we cannot give except that you go towards self-realization and understand that the mind dissolves. But even relatively, practically speaking, you think in terms of trying to understand what this mind is. You will reach to a conclusion that it is a non-existing entity. Ramana Maharishi says, Manasam tu kim margane krite naiva manasam marga arjavat. Manasam tu kim. But what is mind? If you make a direct inquiry like that to the mind itself, oh mind, who are you? Like that you turn and go inside. Then if you ask that straightforward question to the mind, he says the mind withdraws. There is no entity of the mind. There is a lady who wants to impress her lover or husband. She makes herself up with various makeup materials. All this makeup material and wanting to attract is there as long as he is not looking at her. The moment he looks at her, she feels shy and withdraws herself. So all this power and wanting to attract and wanting to see something, it is all there only when you are not looking at the mind, you are looking at the outside world. So the outside world presents a solid seeming world as long as it is there projected or reflected from your mind. Therefore, mind and this world has a simultaneous existence like this. If you are able to not focus on the world and turn towards the mind and ask that question, who you are directly, the mind itself withdraws, he says. That is you can try. That is what he calls as a vichara. Who am I? Who am I? You try to go inside, you will finally hit that only. So, this entity of mind in its real state is a non-existent thing. So, therefore, there is no such thing as inside and outside. But as of now, mind is there, I experience, everything is real, correct. But what is the core of everything inside you is the same thing that is the core of everything outside you, which is the Brahman. So, Brahman is inside everything, Brahman is outside everything. The message in this mantra is that make this nearer to you. That is the message that we can write. Don't wait. See, even when you take the Gita mantras like Bahunam Janmanamante, many Janmas, you have to optimistically take it as, how do you know that you have not crossed all the Janmas before? This could be your last Janma. That must be the spirit. Obviously, in the same Gita, he is also says, Achirena Digachadi. Just like that, you will reach, man. You are there. I'll take you. I'll take you just like that. These are also very, encouraging statements for us to contemplate about. So, therefore, you have to take it as an optimistic stage. That this Janma is my last Janma, I am nearer to God. That sort of a very strong will must be there for us to move forward. That is a message that we can take. But Mantra 4 and Mantra 5 are essentially talking about the Swarupa Lakshana or the nature of Brahman from microcosmic and macrocosmic point of view. That moves not, that is afar, that is even near, that is inside all this, that is even outside all this. Mantras 6 and 7 is a very comprehensive sadhana that is given for reaching the self. The highest concept of Vedanta, which is there given in the Maya portion of the Vedanta treatise, I am just giving a very brief introduction to this mantra. We have to take it up in detail. It is talking about how you can reach Brahman, and this mantra in some form or the other comes up in all Upanishad, because Upanishad doesn't just give the state alone, it gives the path also. And you can never reach Brahman unless until you feel one with others. Everybody, you must feel one with everything. This is what we can derive out of all religions also. There are various verses in Bible or in Quran that may be taken that you have to feel one with others, and that is true love. What you show as true love is bhakti, and being good to all is actually being good to God. So love is a uniting factor that binds everything, and you are reaching a state where you will replace the entire universe with God. This state is called in Vedanta as Savikalpa Samadhi. Samadhi means realization or a state of self-absorption. Savikalpa means that which is there with the thought. That means it is called as partial realization. Partial realization is a very great state where Swami Ramtirtha says many great saints, even he attributes Christ to that state. But then he says beyond that, what has to take you one step further is Vedanta, where knowledge of the self dissolves that entity which is experiencing the divinity also to a state which is beyond experience. That is called as Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Nirvikalpa Samadhi is when there is absolute realization. It is not partial realization, it is total realization. Now, what happens in partial realization, what is the indication and what is the path to get there is given in Mantra 6. And what is total realization, there is a very subtle word that indicates that in Mantra 7. Partial realization and total realization are somewhere very high. We need not try to judge a master whether he is partially realized or totally realized. They are at a very, very high stage. But the ultimate journey culminates in total realization, where a person is completely freed from all types of delusion. So in Mantra 6, he is going to say that you are free from shoka, grief. Then you reach partial realization. You are free from moha, delusion, in total realization. So partial realization is when you cross over extrinsic illusion. Total realization is when you cross over intrinsic illusion. So Mantra 6 and Mantra 7, we'll take it up in the next class. We'll conclude with the bhajans here.
Gopala Keshava, Gopala Keshava.
Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti